The vibe for 1994 tonight on BBC Two, with pivotal movie Pulp Fiction to come at 10 past 10. There's strong language and some violence now in a big year for Britpop, a big year for Brit films, and a big year for breasts. Here's Ava Herzegova, so say a big hello.
Hello, boys and girls. I am Ava Herzegova, and this is 1994.
Maybe. I don't really wanna know how you got in girls, 'cause I just wanna fly. Lately, did you ever feel the pain in the morning rain as it soaks you to the bone? Well, maybe I just wanna fly, wanna live but don't wanna die. Maybe I just wanna breathe. Maybe I just don't.
Who was Hugh Grant before Four Weddings and a Funeral? Where were the lads before Loaded Magazine? And what did we watch before Friends? In 1994, the fashion world also gave women and men what they always wanted, the Wonder Bra, and I became the 90s fashion icon.
This is the rhythm.
Mafia.
Southern softies versus these Northern hard lads.
These people are sick. Can nobody see these people are sick?
They're like this.
Birds, beer, birds, football.
My image on the world's billboards sent traffic screeching to a halt in 1994. The Wonder Bra put cleavage back in vogue and hurled me into supermodel stardom.
Wonder Bras. Wonderful.
Hello, boys.
Hello, boys.
Hello, boys.
Hello, boys. Aren't you pleased to see me?
Big, wonderful things in Wonder Bras.
I remember somebody saying to me, have you had a boob job?
Breath in a Wonder Bra, you had three buttons undone and you went, hey.
I like the, you know, the hoiking up element, the underwiring, like, eh.
The last thing you want to do is ram a couple of mattresses sheathed in some sort of satiny type material underneath your kahunas.
Billboards had never been done really for underwear advertising in the UK, so we wanted to put it somewhere it hadn't been, and that was billboards.
You looked up one day, and on billboards, which you'd never seen before, ever, was this really cute-looking blonde.
God, dear, oh Lord.
I would love to know how much road traffic accidents increased near those billboards at that time.
Guys would be winding their windows down so that they can get a clearer view, so the, you know, because the car's not clean.
Hello, boys. It was just wonderful. You know, you wanted to know about her afterwards.
I was stopped by a friend of mine who was attending a beauty contest, and she didn't want to go on her own. So I ended up going. And there were 400 girls, and I was like, what am I doing here? There's no way I even have a chance. So I left, and the lady from Paris, she noticed me, and she ran after me. She's like, do you want to come to Paris? And that was it. I remember when my agency called me, they said, you're gonna do the guest campaign, and I couldn't believe it. Then came the campaign that would change my life forever. I just went and tried a few bras on, and then I was confirmed, and actually afterwards I heard that they'd been looking for the right girl for like 6 months, couldn't find anyone, did it in Milan, in Paris, in New York, and I thought it was just one of the castings, so I guess I was lucky. Love, life and laughter is all I believe. It made a lot of newspapers. It was kind of a scandal.
The sort of things that people were complaining about were that the ads were sexist and offensive.
It's not like I was naked. It's not porno going on. So there was nothing wrong with it. I thought it was image of a confident woman.
She wasn't somebody caught out in her underwear. She was somebody going, hey, look at me. Who's got the power? She's got the power.
Apart from me being surprised, I think also the Wonder Bra people were very surprised. They were not prepared, they were not ready, so they couldn't supply the market.
We sold 10 million bras in 1994. It's a huge phenomenon.
Suddenly it seemed that all women had great breasts. Or maybe it was just a phase I was going through.
I had them in black, cream, satin, laced.
You wore diaphanous tops, sheer chiffon numbers, so that your Wonder Bra would show through. That was a real look, to look like a complete tramp.
If one was lucky enough to pull, you didn't want to take your bra off. Where have they gone?
Sometimes you get something out of the package, it doesn't really look that good, does it? You know, the lettuce goes limp.
I got a little bit tired of being recognized only as the face of the Wonder Bra.
So you don't want me to talk about Eva's tender tushy?
No.
How about her big boobies?
I was not just a pair of breasts.
Is it true that you don't like your feet?
They're quite big.
can we compare our feet? Okay. Let's do this. Let's see who's got the biggest feet. They're the same, aren't they?
It was a time of the supermodels, the 90s, and I believe that I fitted in. I was there at the right time, and I was, I don't know, I was just a fresh, young girl that looked like a woman.
Every decade needs its own sound, and in 94, it was Britpop.
In the mid-90s, it was Britpop. Whatever Britpop was.
Britpop, as it became, was very polite. It was sort of lads who liked a bit of Paul Weller and had some mod T-shirts and were a bit arty.
It was something that was coined by the press and that was quite irksome to most bands.
And it was quite southern, and suddenly there were these drunk, drug-taking, cigarette-smoking blokes who hated each other's guts. It was bloody magic.
Yes, it's happened. They're here.
I've got mud for it.
Thank God. Praise the Lord for the Gallaghers. I need to be myself.
I can't be no one else. Oasis were quite clearly this gang of thugs from a place no one had heard of, you know, Burnage. I think some people in Manchester had heard of Burnage in the way that, you know, some people in hell have heard of Satan.
Their arrogance was like, whoa, whey, God blimey, you know, they're going to cause trouble.
We just want to be the biggest band in the world.
As big as we can be.
Today, for today, and that is it, end of story.
And we've got all the things that go with it. Oh, I want to be a big pop star, and I want to do loads of people's heads in, because they're going, look at him, and I'm going, yeah. You know what I mean?
Maybe I don't really want to know how your garden grows, because I just want to fly.
Brilliant band. England's best band at the moment, I'd say.
Well, they're just really new, and they're just really fresh.
Just an amazing band.
A lot of people get embarrassed about all this success that they get. They go, oh, I didn't really want it. You know what I mean? Of course you wanted it. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because that's what you go out for.
You used to live down there?
I used to live down there. I just played nothing.
As a kid, Noel, he was quiet. He was just sitting in his room, playing his guitar. All you could always hear was, meow, shut my mama go, turn that down.
I got caught shoplifting in that co-op round back there, man. That's when I first got caught.
All the magic mushrooms down there, laugh your head off down there.
Noel Gallagher auditioned for the Inspiro Carpets as a vocalist, and they turned him down.
Husband don't know what he's done. Kids don't know what's wrong with mum.
We gave him the lyric sheet to sing, and he started laughing. I said, what are you laughing at? He said, these words are crap. I'm like, I wrote that. It's one of my best songs, you cheeky little sod.
This is how it feels to be lonely. This is how it feels to be small.
He could sing, but he couldn't sing the kind of style they wanted, so we ended up taking him on as a roadie.
And then 91, Liam formed Oasis with Gwigsy, Bonehead, Tony McCarroll.
He was on the phone to his brother one day, and he comes off and he says, you won't believe it, but our kids started a band, and we were like, well, we always said he looked like a pop star.
He went from the assumption that he wasn't put on this earth to dig holes or paint fences or do anything that anyone else done. He was put on this earth for something better than that. He wanted to be noticed.
The swaggering arrogance of Oasis came from the Stone Roses. Liam Gallagher saw Ian Brown and he saw like the best rock star of that generation.
I don't think he wanted to be Ian Brown, he just wanted to be where Ian Brown was. He'd done a show in the Boardwalk in Manchester, and Noel was in the crowd, and he must have just seen some of the Liam had, and he just went, right, I'm joining Oasis.
He just thought, right, yeah, I can make him a bit better because I've got proper songs.
Very rarely do you ever see a band and just know. And I think a lot of people just thought, oh yeah, they're gonna do it. They really are gonna do it.
Maybe I don't really wanna know how your garden grows, 'cause I just wanna fly.
I mean, the reason why we're in every paper is because there's something to write about.
Noel and Liam, always fighting.
In the morning rain.
They argued, they fought.
But in everyone's face.
We're like a rock and roll version of Sooty and Sweep.
Say what we'll do, we'll tell you what we'll do. Do sad song last, yeah? So you can just play your little game. Alright? It's like there's days when I've needed a slap and he's slapped me. And there's days when he's needed a slap, so I've slapped him. We're on a big fight, we haven't talked for about 2 months.
My mum used to be annoyed about it because the brothers at the end of the day, they've got to stick together.
Did we have an argument about that one?
It was always sad for me to see. You know, from afar, that this band having problems, and Noel and Liam having this kind of huge fallout.
I'm in a good run at the moment. I haven't argued for about a day. Pretty good.
But enough of you.
Dance.
You know, so the big bass drum came out and the bouncy bass line.
Being Mockney, didn't they? I called them, they were Mockney.
Well, it was an oddball tune, Park Life. Damon came up with it all on his own, really.
Confidence is a preference for the habitual voyeur of what is known as...
good, the video. I enjoyed doing the video because, you know, it meant I could do a bit of acting as well as doing a bit of singing.
John Scott Brewer's group, he gets intimidated by the dirty pigeons. They love a bit of him.
They've been
build it as the intelligent indie band versus the working class hard nuts from Manchester.
Strange, you know, because you probably couldn't get two bands that were more diametrically opposed.
The press hyped up the rivalry between Blur and Oasis. It came to a head the following year.
We didn't start this band to get into competition with some other band. We started this band to be Oasis, to be what we want it to be.
I think there probably was some genuine old-fashioned hatred there.
They're not worthy of being mentioned in the same breath as us.
I mean, the first rule of being in a band is that you don't get to be enormous by saying everyone else is shit.
Liam likes to be more in your face than I do. But I'm harder.
All everybody wanted to know was, is Liam Gallagher a wanker?
He said a lot of things about my group behind our backs, you know what I mean, that we've heard about, and they were insulting things. And that's fine, that's fair enough. If he's not got a bottle say to our faces, then, you know, see you later.
Two of Britain's most popular pop groups have begun the biggest chart war in 30 years. The Manchester band Oasis and their arch rivals Blur released new singles today, each hoping to reach the number one spot next week.
Pop battle.
Southern softies versus these northern hard lads. You gotta roll with it,
you gotta take it time. You either Oasis or you was Blur, you know.
Did have arguments with people whether they were a Blur fan or an Oasis fan.
It was pantomime, darling. I think it captured the people's imagination, didn't it? For a brief moment.
And at number two, it's Oasis with Roll With It.
And that can mean only one thing. Although it's a taking part that's important, not the winning. We don't want a civil war, but tonight, there's no denying, Blur are top of the pops. Sad story of the games.
I don't think anyone cared about the fact that Blur won that particular battle because the war was inevitably going to be won by Oasis. Today is going to be the day that they're going to throw it back to you. When I heard the demos come through of Morning Glory, they had these incredible songs.
I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now.
Wonderwall was a... Oh, I wish I'd written that.
Backbeat, the word is on the street that the fire in your heart is...
I like the song Wonderwall. I think it's one of the standouts in the album. But you never really had a doubt.
I never think, get up and think, oh well, you know, I have to write a song today. I just wait for it to come along and pick the little bits out. And when it happens, it's usually good.
I think Noel is a standout as a songwriter. Anytime Noel wants to write a song with me, I'd love to do it.
The world was losing faith in British movies until 1994, when Four Weddings and a Funeral became a blockbuster.
This is...
Carrie.
Carrie. Delighted, I'm John.
Hi, John.
So, John, how's that gorgeous girlfriend of yours?
She's no longer my girlfriend.
Ah, dear. Still, I wouldn't get too gloomy about it. Rumour has it she never stopped bonking old Toby Delisle, just in case you didn't work out.
She is now my wife.
It just made me laugh. I mean, it simply made me laugh.
Any kids or anything, John? Do we hear the patter of tiny feet?
It was like posh friends passing round the partners amongst other posh friends.
Tell me, are you married?
No.
Are you a lesbian?
People now look back and think, oh, it was this really sort of soft,
romantic comedy. And in fact, the first 17 words of the film were fuck.
Oh, fuck.
There aren't very many beginnings of films that I can remember. I can remember certain bits in films, but that was perfect.
Fuck.
It had power and it was immediately, you were right in there.
Fuck.
That's waking up alarm clocks, dashing around, trying to get ready for this wedding.
Oh, fuck.
It isn't until your mother gets to see it that you realise quite how shocking it is. And I must say, it sort of did knock her back for about half an hour.
Fuck it!
This is the last 30 seconds of film that we have in the camera, so I'll stop rabbiting on, because I'm just some git with stupid hair who you've never heard of, and Andy's this fabulous goddess, and every time she opens her mouth, it's heaven. So I'll shut up and over to Andy to tell you everything you need to know about Four Weddings and a Funeral.
Amen.
Bugger. Bugger.
And I know it's stupid.
It made a huge star out of Hugh Grant.
Hi.
I mean, he has got a real charisma.
Words of David Cassidy, in fact. While he was still with the Partridge family. I think I love you.
It's quite an old-fashioned sort of appeal, actually. It's a direct sort of reaction to after the sort of big, hunking, hulky action heroes.
This is only the second time I've ever been a best man. I hope I did the job all right that time. The couple in question are at least still talking to me.
He also had this thing which, of course, has become a kind of trademark with him from then on, which is the stutter.
Unfortunately, they're not actually talking to each other. The divorce came through a couple of months ago.
It was that combination of being vulnerable and also hunky at the same time.
Hello, Charles.
Oh, Hen. Hi.
Charles's main problem in the film was that he couldn't commit to any girl, but he was desperate to get married.
God, no, marry you and I've had to marry your friends, and I'm not quite sure I could take Fiona.
Fiona loves you.
Fiona calls me duckface.
When he eventually did choose to marry me, it was obviously out of complete desperation, wasn't it?
Do you love someone else? Do you, Charles?
He jilts her at the altar.
I do.
And then I hit him very hard.
He lamps him and he goes down, and I love that as well. It's going, come on, yes!
Ah, great, the speeches.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen,
pray silence for the best man.
When you say, I don't remember, who were you in it? You go, I was the one who made the best man speech about the guy. Oh, yeah, yeah.
When Bernard told me he was getting engaged to Lydia, I congratulated him because all his other girlfriends had been such complete dogs. Although, may I say how delighted we are to have so many of them here this evening.
The audience had been laughing, 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 then suddenly, bang, they go through another door.
The first time that funeral, oh, goodness. I mean, I think even in the screening, people had tears in their eyes.
Our service will begin in a few minutes. But first, we have asked Matthew, Gareth's closest friend, to say a few words.
Mike Newell and Richard were very canny in their handling of the gay relationship.
Silence the pianos and with muffled drum, bring out the coffin. Let the mourners come.
Because I think they wanted people only gradually to realise that they were an item.
He was my north, my south, my east and west. My working week and my Sunday rest.
And it's then at the funeral that the whole weight of the relationship is revealed.
My noon, my midnight, my talk, my song. I thought that love would last forever. I was wrong.
Tonight, a British film, which for the past 2 months has been the top box office attraction in the United States, gets its London premiere. Four Weddings and a Funeral cost a fraction of the average Hollywood feature, and it's already earned some $30 million for its producers.
They realised that actually, that it was possible to make a film here in the UK that could find an audience all around the world, and a big audience at that.
What I remember about the premiere is Liz Hurley in that dress. think I've ever seen anything like it, really.
Oh, with the safety pins. Liz Hurley.
I saw what she was wearing. I went, whoa.
Nobody knew who she was.
I mean, the whole safety pin thing going right down the side of the dress.
It was a dress held up with safety pins. Loads of naked flesh on show.
A seminal moment in sartorial lack of clothing. You bring the body
and I'll bring the sting. He was looking down at her, going, wow. It suddenly dawned on him that how fabulous she looked. And he's thinking, well, all the attention's really on you and not on me.
The only time that I've seen the precise moment where somebody got to be a star.
She was made, that dress was made, and our film got the best launch that it possibly could.
Baidu.
The title song from Four Weddings gave Wet, Wet, Wet an unexpected hit. It went to number one and stayed there forever.
I feel it in my finger. I feel it in my toe.
I wrote Lovers All Around in late 67. That's the Troggs. And so the feeling
grows. I loved it. For a whole year, I didn't need to go and buy it anyway because it was constantly on the radio.
It's been there for 12 weeks. Will they be there next week?
Well, it's 14 weeks as the UK's number one. If they go two more, they could equal Bryan Adams, if that's what they want.
Stayed at number one for 15 weeks. They were hitting me with hundreds of thousands of pounds, and I went, yeah.
Even Wet, Wet, Wet were fed up with it, weren't they, after about the first 8 weeks? My mind's made up
by the way that I feel. And it may, just may have been what tipped the balance and broke the band up. So I am so sorry. There were songs that were coming up the chart and I thought, this one will knock it off. Oh, no, this one will.
I think they were happy to let somebody else come in and take over the limelight because they were there for, like, God, forever, you know?
And I did think at the time, thank God for that, because I'd rather look at, you know, Wigfield jiggling about than look at Marty Pallo with his daft ponytail. And I'm sure he would.
She sounded like Daffy Duck.
Sort of demented electronic quacking like a duck on heat. Saturday night, I feel the air is getting
hot. Pretty baby. Just a bit annoying, wasn't it? I'll make you mine, you know I'll take you to the
top. I'll drive you crazy. Basically, it's a girl who's getting ready to go out Saturday night. The way you move,
pretty baby. It's a horrible thought that it was one of the biggest hits of 1994. It just tells you what kind of music we were buying in 1994. It became a hit in Spain, so the result of that was lots and lots of tourists going out. They would hear it.
They'd bring it back with them. You know what I mean? Cool, I'd rather them come back with rabies.
This crazy, silly little dance that they had to. Everybody danced and made these other stupid moves.
The Wigfield dance.
Guy from Valencia, he was an aerobic instructor and he was doing this routine on the beach in the summer and people would do it. And this thing just ended up, you know, around the world.
Run to that dance floor, form the lines, and start doing the dance.
They're like this, 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 this.
He was always one that jumped the wrong way when everybody else went the other way.
Jump.
And the DJ would start to laugh at you. So then you'd run up and push his decks over, and then you'd get barred.
I've never been a great dancer, so I had these, you know, pictured routines sent to me by fax. And I'm like in my house going, I'm not gonna do that.
Stop it, will you? I'll make you mine, you know.
1994, the world was glued to their television sets in morbid fascination. American football hero turned film star O.J. Simpson was filmed driving a white Bronco down an L.A. freeway. This really was reality TV.
One of the most famous men in America, on the run from police and facing double murder charges, which could bring the death penalty.
I mean, it was just an incredible story. It was one of those you couldn't make it up kind of things.
Most people are, O.J. who?
O.J. Simpson was spotted by a California highway patrolman some 60 miles from Los Angeles.
And because who was driving this car? One of their biggest American football heroes of all time.
It's O.J. Simpson's superstar status as a record-breaking football player, which makes his fall from grace so hard for fans to take.
Hey, O.J.
Huh?
What makes Tree Sweet Orange so good?
Tree Sweet Oranges, Tommy. They're always tree sweet.
The O.J. chase in the white Bronco from the, I guess it was the copter cam that was following the whole thing. You just couldn't rip your eyes away from that television.
Bob, you've got audio.
Bob,
go ahead.
We're over the 5 freeway, past the 55 freeway. O.J. Simpson is believed to be in the white Bronco that you see in the center of your picture.
We were on the air live. The very first picture is of the O.J. Simpson infamous slow speed pursuit.
Followed by as many as 9 Orange County Sheriff's deputies.
He had a gun, and he was threatening to take his own life. I remember watching it and saying to myself, this is going to end badly.
It does not appear as though the driver is slowing down or complying with the orders of the officers.
What I really remember were thousands of people lining the freeway, waving O.J. on.
And people are chanting, go O.J. go.
You couldn't actually see O.J. if you see a guy driving the car. It wasn't O.J. though.
He's accused of murdering his ex-wife Nicole and her friend Ronald Goldman outside her Los Angeles home.
This was the ultimate in reality television. Forget Survivor, forget shows like Big Brother. This was the real thing.
I was surprised at the response to the OJ programs in Britain. Week after week, more than 1 million people would stay up late on a Sunday night to watch a trial about a man they didn't know, lawyers they didn't know.
Either put Cordoba on the
stand. Excuse me, Mr. Bailey.
Stop her from
testifying. Stand up and speak when it's your turn.
If she argues 2 days, I could argue 4 days. I feel so passionate about this case, I could argue from now on.
There was a mate of mine who was just been made redundant, and he spent every day watching it all day.
Some of the lawyers didn't get along. There was a lot of antagonism.
We certainly aren't going to yell at Your Honor and become hysterical. We would, I just point out...
That characterization, okay, well, that kind of personal attack is very improper and inappropriate, and I think the court should not countenance that kind of behavior.
I don't.
She finished?
He killed her because he couldn't have her.
I was confused by it, and I'm sure they were.
It was a media circus, and you, it was really hard not to lose sight of the fact that at the end of the day, it was a murder trial.
Don't squeeze the juice unless you're the jury!
It was wrong, but you couldn't help yourself. You were fascinated by this theater.
You know, when he was like trying on that glove, is it going to fit? Is it going to be too small?
If the glove don't fit...
You must acquit.
Which sounded like some MC Hammer line.
And the prosecution was so foolish for allowing O.J. Simpson to walk right up to the jury, try it on, and say to them, it doesn't fit, it's too small.
Have reached a verdict in this case. Is that correct, Madam Foreman?
More people in the world tuned in to watch the verdict than any other event in the history of television.
Juror number 5, as to count 1, is this your verdict?
Yes.
Juror number 6, as to count 1, is this your verdict?
Yes.
The big criticism came when we won. Everybody thought O.J. Simpson had the right to due process as long as he lost.
And he got off, and all of a sudden, everyone's like, oh!
We, the jury, in the above entitled action, find the defendant, Orenthal James Simpson, not guilty of a crime.
Yeah. Oh, my word.
It was race. That was the major issue.
I'm very relieved. I'm finally getting to see some justice here in Los Angeles.
Black people, we weren't really rooting for O.J. We were rooting for Johnny Cochran. We liked the fact that a black attorney went in there and got down.
I just like to say how grateful we are for this verdict.
But the verdict has left prosecutors and the victims' families devastated.
We came here in search of justice,
You'll have to be the judges, I expect, as to whether or not any of us found it.
State had failed to prove, by admissible evidence, its case beyond a reasonable doubt.
Somebody played with this evidence.
Maybe we learned what a lot of people should have known is that money is very useful in the criminal justice system in America.
In 1994, a new man's magazine had a spectacular launch. Loaded discovered that inside every new man was a young lad screaming to get out. Good work, fellas.
It was gadgets, it was booze, it was tits, it was 1,000% bloke.
If you really want to know what was going on in the 90s, just go back and look at those early Loaded covers.
A magazine for men that was a lifestyle magazine with a little bit of titillating naked lady-age.
Birds, beer, birds, football.
Oh, boys will be boys.
It's a sort of commercial wank magazine.
If you're a real lad, you'd have just reached straight up there for a copy of Reader's Wise, wouldn't you? And gone home and bashed the bishop.
I knew that most of the guys in the country weren't like those other magazines like GQ and Arena were telling them they were. They weren't driving around in Range Rovers with very expensive Savile Row suits. The basic idea of Loaded for the content was music and football. And then, of course, you put everything else around it.
I think we just caught some wave in the 90s because the 80s had been fairly miserable. Then we got into the 90s and things started to loosen up a bit. You know, Oasis happened, Wonder Bra adverts were everywhere with girls like this on billboards. Suddenly you could say bird, you could say tits, you could go out and get drunk. It just seemed like a good time, and we just were part of it and caught that wave.
My memories are Loaded.
It's breasts.
We took a conscious decision to let's put British breast back at the front of the debate. GQs and the Arenas and the Esquires, they'd have women in, but they were trying to pass it off as art.
Our whole thing was, well, you haven't got to be Kate Moss to go on the cover Loaded.
As long as they got their lady bumps out in an attractive fashion, why, then they could be on the cover.
I think we chose Kathy to go on the cover because she was about as close as you could get to most Loaded blokes' fantasy woman.
It was a really hot summer's day, I seem to remember, and everyone just started drinking, and I had a tight corset on, and I probably nearly passed out, but I remember saying, I'm so hot, I'm really, really hot.
Loaded magazine treated women as sex objects, but they portrayed the women as being in control of the situation.
It wasn't just page three girls and models, it was actors, actresses, you name it. Everybody was getting their kiss off of Loaded.
It was a great breath of fresh air. Fresh air, granted, stinking of stale lager and Marlboro Lights.
The perception that we were really heavy football hooligan geezers, it was just like, wasn't like that. And it was, you know, that was our detractors would either say sexist lads.
It's really laddie. It's written by lads, what do you expect? It's a lads mag.
You know, and it wasn't like that. We were just everyday guys, more like, you know, the likely lads.
Excuse me. That's lads.
Nothing really happened for 3 weeks, or we'd just go mental for 3 weeks. And the last week would just be all hands to the pump, and you'd work 24 hours a day, and it would come out, and somehow you'd sort of wake up one morning, and there'd be this magazine. You'd think, how the hell did that happen? What's the frequency, can at the shop
in Sardinia? One of the first brilliant articles I remember was the Crisp World Cup.
Cheese and onion v salt and vinegar v Quavers.
Photos of each packet of crisps at every stage, it was fantastic.
These were the important matters of the times, you know. We rang the Pope the guy in the Vatican, it was like 11 o'clock at the night, answered the phone. He said, which do you think is the better crisp, X or Y? And the guy said, I think he's a Hula Hoops man.
What's your connection with Loaded?
Well, I know all the guys. I know James and Tim and everyone. They gave me a call and asked me if I wanted to come.
They drank themselves silly most nights and hung out with gorgeous models who also like drinking most nights.
Hello, Rachel. Rachel Darling.
Yeah?
Hello, I'm the editor of Loaded.
To me, the big thing about Loaded was that it was about hedonism.
I'm not going
to
lick your arse again.
I can't remember paying for anything for 3 years. And that included drugs, sex, food, clothes. We just live in a fantasy lifestyle.
It would be champagne and cocaine.
It just went on and on and on and on.
That's just the best lad life in the world. And getting paid for it. Bastards. I'm a loser, baby,
so why don't you kill me? He thought we were the new gods, but we weren't. We were just a bunch of pillocks having a good time.
In the 90s, friends gave us a bunch of new mates to hang out with in TV land on a Friday night. Meet Rachel, Ross, Chandler, Joey, Phoebe, and Monica.
My favourite friend, well, Rachel, ain't it? Because I fancied her.
Phoebe, can I see you for a second?
I love Phoebe. I think Phoebe's very funny.
Cookie, ditzy, weirdy girl.
Phoebe? It's a great name.
Oh, you like that? You should hear my phone number.
Chandler was my favourite.
Naturally Chandler.
I think it's got to be Chandler.
I just find Chandler a completely adorable.
So, I guess we wear swimsuits in here.
He's the one character that, when I'm watching Friends, I'll always laugh out loud.
You've had a lot of sex, right?
You know, I did associate myself with Joey.
When? Today?
It's my Latin looks, I suppose.
Some, not a lot.
I think that any good television comedy is ultimately about family.
Come on, Chandler, I love your mom. I think she's a blast.
You could say that because she's not your mom.
Oh, please. She's the...
Buona sera.
Hi, sweetie.
When did Rigatoni get back from Rome?
Joey's the dumb brother, and Chandler is the sarcastic older brother, and Rachel's the pretty sister, and everyone had their own role in that family, but at the end of the day, they were there to support one another.
You broke the code.
What code?
You don't kiss your friend's mom. Sisters are okay, maybe a hot-looking aunt, but not a mom. Never a mom! Stop!
This little tiny show that the 10 of us invented in a room became a genuine pop culture phenomenon.
Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Matt LeBlanc, Matthew Perry, and David Schwimmer!
Well, NBC had this genius catchphrase they came up with for it, must-see TV.
Not only was it must-see TV, it was must-tape TV.
I also loved on a Sunday after lunch, sitting, watching all of the tapes back to back.
First time I met Chandler, I thought he was gay.
You would cancel your dates, you'd put the kids to bed to see this show.
But here I am singing on his wedding day.
Anyone fancy any of the girls, David?
We had like a silent agreement that became verbal after a while that really that nothing was going to cross the friendship boundary that the six of us kind of established right from the start. So.
And now that's all out the window.
Now it's just sex, sex, sex. Whoa, let's rehearse, let's have sex, let's rehearse.
Sounds like you have a good time.
Yeah, it's kind of fun.
The Rachel cut became the hottest hairstyle of the 90s.
People were going in salons going, give me a Rachel.
Basically, what you were trying to buy into was, you know, Jennifer's incredible cuteness and sex appeal.
It's not as though it was the first time I'd ever seen this haircut.
And it all looked kind of zhuzhy and kind of fantastic.
I walked out of that hair salon practically in tears thinking, oh, I don't know what the hell he did in my hair. I'm wearing a hat for a year.
On average, each stylist was doing about 3 or 4 a day. I had 16 stylists over a week. That was just under 400 a week we were doing. An oversized pack, letting the most popular hairstyle in my lifetime of hairdressing.
Now this is the theme tune to the dead popular programme about some friends called Friends.
I don't know anybody who don't like Friends.
I don't like it.
No, either do I. Oh, Brembrandt!
When it starts, you've got to go and get your, go and get ready and sit in your sofa, put your arm around your girlfriend and watch it.
So no one knows that life, what life, that life.
I can't remember the words. Isn't that dreadful?
Has anyone got a lyric sheet?
It was such a great pastiche of the Monkees and R.E.M. And the Beatles, and it just was an instant classic.
I'll be there for you.
I'll be there for you, cause you're there for me too.
At the time, the sitcom theme song was a dying breed. Friends completely reversed that trend. All of a sudden people said, well gosh, that's like every time you hear that song on the radio, it's like a commercial for the show.
It wasn't the most acceptable thing inside the rock community to do that sort of a thing. We thought, we'll keep this a secret. No one will ever know it's us. And it just took off. There was no stopping it, and it just went straight to number one and stayed there for 11 weeks. There was a point in time I just felt like, again and again and again, how many times can you play a song in a day? At this point in my life, I'm proud of it because, you know, look at what it is. That's a piece of television history, and it's undeniable.
In 94, street tough fashion took the world by storm. Oversized and overpriced, it was the best thing that ever happened to a couple of unlikely designers.
I could wait to get to America to get Hilfiger stuff.
Tommy Hilfiger boxer shorts.
Hilfiger puffer.
Tommy Hilfiger t-shirts.
Give me the stuff.
There's something about what I do that pushes the buttons. Whether they're preppies or hip-hop kids, they love it. They sing about it, as you know.
Grand Poobah was one of the first artists to put Hilfiger on the map.
I started mentioning them in records, and it kind of blew them up.
The minute it hits the stores, it sells out. And the bigger the name, and the bigger and brighter the colors, the better it sells.
I got me some Seagram's gin, and everybody got their cup, but they ain't chipped in.
Snoop Dogg on Saturday Night Live came out in a big Hilfiger sweatshirt. And the story was, by Monday, you could not find that sweatshirt in any store in New York or L.A.
Most of the designers were like, oh no, I don't want these street people wearing my stuff. What Tommy Hilfiger did was go, okay, the street people want to wear it? Come and do my fashion show. Hey, ho,
hey, ho. They wanted to get into that urban, you know, market, so they felt as though I would be a good person to represent them to take it to the streets.
There was a more delicate dance for Ralph Lauren than for Hilfiger. With Ralph Lauren, it was this preppy, pristine American image.
It's your first step towards the goal of living it. And a lot of us don't have the money to do all the things at once, and so we wear the clothes that set the mood and the tone.
What you're doing is you're saying, I'm special and I'm from the ghetto. And I think a lot of the kids were wearing all these designers and wearing Ralph Lauren because they wanted to have something zesty on and hot.
Thaisa Bedford was one of the first black models that women absolutely desired.
Now, how beautiful is Thaisa Bedford?
Oh, he was gorgeous.
One of the most beautiful men in the world.
Yes, totally.
Ralph Lauren was using Thaisa Bedford as a symbol of, you know, polo.
I think that was one of the
the big boost in the sales is because I was a street kid that, you know, that everybody knew, that got put in a place that everybody was familiar with, and they were like, okay, that's my brother right there. I'm just gonna go get that shirt because he's got it on.
Hip hop became the most vital and dominant pop music for kids. And these designers welcomed that and said, if there's money to be made, let's go for it. And hip hop fashion became the defining look for that generation.
In 1994, Quentin Tarantino made a hip gangster flick. We had never seen anything like Pulp Fiction before. The music, the dancing, and most of all, the writing. You know what they call a quarter pounder with cheese in Paris?
It's got drugs, it's got sex, it's got incredible lashings of cool.
Everybody be cool, this is a robbery!
It was just raw.
It's got freaks, it's got weirdos, it's got sparkling dialogue.
Every time my fingers touch brain, I'm super fly TNT.
Really intricate dialogue going on about nothing.
Would you give a guy a phone, son?
It was a genius movie.
What was in the case? What was in the glowing case?
What's in the case?
Tim Roth and his girlfriend. Like Bonnie and Clyde.
I love you, honey bunny.
These people are sick. Can nobody see these people are sick?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He just pounds it into her chest.
She just sits up so.
Pulp Fiction is a great, great movie, isn't it? It's like Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid for the 90s.
You know what the funniest thing about Europe is?
What?
It's the little differences. I mean, they got the same shit over there that they got here, but it's just there, it's a little different.
Example.
These are regular, everyday guys, you know, except they happen to be hitmen. And they got stuff on their mind, and they're going to talk about it. And Quentin gets into their heads, and then it just goes.
You know what they call a quarter pounder with cheese in Paris?
What do they call it?
They call it Royale with cheese.
What do they call a Whopper?
I don't know. I didn't go on a Burger King.
Quentin has an extraordinary, like, anchor. He has an anchor in pop culture, and he grew up in that pop culture. That's part of his upbringing. That's who he is.
We're all going to be like three little Fonzies here. And what's Fonzie like? Come on, Yolanda, what's Fonzie like?
Cool.
What?
Cool.
Correctamundo.
Hi, I'm Ronald Bell of Cool in the Gang, and everything is Cool in the Gang.
An amazing soundtrack. Undiscovered or forgotten music.
Jungle Boogie is dun 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 dun
dun dun. I still say Cool in the Gang.
That's all Cool in the Gang.
You know, I don't know where I got it from, and then I watched Pulp Fiction the other day and I realised Samuel Jackson said Cool in the Gang.
That's Cool in the Gang.
I used to say, yeah, how's that arch Cool in the Gang, man?
There's one person, there's one actor who can really, really embodies Quentin's dialogue, is Sam Jackson.
Samuel L. Jackson. The L stands for large. Lush.
Looks like me and Vincent caught you boys at breakfast. Sorry about that.
He was so entertaining. He stole every scene he was in.
You, Lock and Seagulls. You know why we're here?
Filming the scene, it was intimidating. He scared me. And then he had the big gun and everything. Yeah, that was spooky.
Why don't you tell my man Vincent where you got the shit here at?
It's over there. It's...
I don't remember asking you a goddamn thing.
Fear was so real. Because, I mean, even though I'd met this man, and we were just in makeup a couple hours ago together, all of a sudden, there is someone else's eyes looking at me.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did I break your concentration?
In my mind, whenever I watch the scene, there's a drum beat that starts then.
You were saying something about best intentions? Oh, well, allow me to retort. What country are you from?
What?
What? What ain't no country I ever heard of?
What?
Say what one more goddamn time?
What?
There's few people that know how to shoot crime, and Tarantino knows how to do it.
It got to a point where everyone was talking about was the violence. Pulp Fiction is so much more. It's the humor, it's the dialogue, it's the character. Billy Ray was the preacher's son, and when
his daddy would visit, he'd come along. If I tell people I was in Pulp Fiction, they're like, oh, you were the Marilyn in Pulp Fiction? I'm like, yeah. Blink and you miss me. He made me the person that John Travolta sees when he walks in and he's kind of all stoned out on heroin.
was the son of a preacher man, the only boy.
Ladies and gentlemen, now the moment you've all been waiting for, the world famous Jack Rabbit Slim's Twist Contest.
The whole set couldn't wait for John to dance. It was like John's gonna dance today. Everybody was waiting because we all loved John Travolta.
Now, who will be our first contestant?
Right here.
She was nervous about doing the dance.
Wanna dance?
I talked to her about the twist and we practiced it together and we all worked it out a little bit. And they both got it.
It was a teenage wedding and the old folks wished them well.
I was completely embarrassed because at first I thought, oh, no, you know, I'm such a big geek, and to try and dance with John Travolta, although the camp value of that was just too much to resist.
John Travolta dancing, and he hadn't danced on screen in 15 years, and all of a sudden he's overweight and he's out there doing the twist.
John Travolta dancing like a thug.
This was quite a weird dance between the two of them. It was kind of like a mating courtship. And they start doing all this weird kind of 60s, you know, getting down to it.
I can remember we were all doing that, like, for ages afterwards.
He was sort of dancing, like, going through the steps because he'd know that we were going to go into the swim or something.
She's the vamp. Her whole style, her hair, that black wig with the fringe, that kind of Cleopatra look and the red lips.
Poster of that film when she's lying on the bed, that'd be the image that most people remember of her. That's her kind of classic kind of moments, isn't it?
Bring out the gimp.
Go get the gimp.
The gimp's sleeping.
Love the gimp.
Where'd you advertise for gimps?
I've got the outfit. It's true.
That's what I want for Christmas. A gimp of my video.
I was sort of hanging out with Quentin Tarantino. He said, Steve, would you like to come and audition for the gimp? And I said, yeah, sure. And he said, because we're just getting all these freaks coming in. Yeah. When I read the scene, I just thought, wow, it's heavy. I mean, it's really bizarre and really creepy, and I thought this will never make it to the film.
Shocking scene. Shocking scene.
It's a nice thing to have been a part of, even a little gimpy part.
We like sex, violence, humor. And a story, if you can put all them in a film, you're a genius. And he did. That is his defining moment. I don't think he'll ever make a film as good as that again. The boy's no good. Well, I finally found what I'm
looking for, but if they get a chance, I'll end it for sure. Years don't come much better than 1994. Listen, go get a beer, a glass of wine, or a cup of tea. You've got to be back in 2 minutes, because next, it's the best film of the 90s, Pulp Fiction. Bye now. We're 7 seconds away, but just as long as I stay, I'll be waiting. Ooh, it's 9 seconds. We're 7 seconds away, but just as long as I stay, I'll be waiting. Ooh, it's 1 second. We're 7 seconds away, but just as long. Want to know what happened in 95? Call back in a couple of weeks.
Kaiser Soze.
Kaiser Soze.
Is that about blowjobs?
I find you're acting a little bit woody.
Oh, you can fuck off.
Oh, yeah.